Hello students, welcome to the class on answer writing, and in this class I will be dealing with the answers to the questions that I have posted on brainiki.com on 20th of October. Now the question number one was, amid the rising fear of deflation, what should be the role of IMF? Comment. Now there is a rising specter of deflation, and what role the IMF should be playing. Now first of all, you must define clearly in this answer about what is the role of the IMF. IMF stands for correcting the balance of the payment issues of the various countries, and along with that, the second most important role that has to be played by the IMF is with respect to the surveillance, that it has to conduct the surveillance of the financial and the economic system of the entire world, and it has to provide guidance, it has to provide recommendations of what corrective measures needs to be taken in order to the arresting of the crisis, financial crisis. And the third role that it has to play is a developmental role. Now if you look at all these three roles with respect to balance of payment crisis, with respect to surveillance, and with respect to development, it becomes the responsibility, ipso facto responsibility of IMF to help the world ward from this danger of deflation that we are facing. Now deflation is the fall in the prices. Now why there is a fall in the prices? The fall in the prices is because of the lesser demand. Though the production infrastructure still exists, but the demand has gone down. Now it's the duty of the IMF to create unified policies world over. Now what is happening is that the American Federal Bank, it is on the verge to do away with the quantitative easing. Now once that quantitative easing would be done away with, it will create a pressure on the Asian economies. The entire money that had flown from United States of America to India and the Asian countries, the entire money will be flowing back, it will be flying back. Now, but if you look at the mandate of the IMF, IMF cannot enforce the countries to follow particular policies. It can only create a situation, it can only exert a pressure because of its economic prowess. But it has no legitimate right to ask any country to perform a particular role. And keeping this thing in mind, we must not criticize IMF to the level the way it is being criticized for the moment. It had failed to predict 2008 economic crisis, it had failed to predict the Brazil economic crisis, it had failed to predict the pigs crisis, it had failed to predict the Chinese slowdown, China's slowdown. So the things are not that easy to predict in economics. So you must be writing all these things. So the second question is, formulate a framework for the new education policy. Now this is an open-ended question, but the paper check will give you good marks only if you will be building up a framework of the education policy in a holistic manner. So what the paper check is looking for is your individuality about the education sector, of how holistically you are aware about that sector. So when you will be talking about the framework, you should not be taking into consideration only the primary, secondary, senior secondary education, but also the higher education and the professionalized courses. Then you should be focusing on the syllabus content of the syllabus, then you should be focusing on the scope of the syllabus, then you should be focusing on the nature of the syllabus, then you should be focusing on the infrastructure, then you should be focusing on urban and rural education landscape, then you should be focusing on the use of the information technology in the education sector, and then you should be focusing on the right to get educated. Now we are currently on this fundamental right is just from 6 year till 14 year, but what after 14 year and what before you are 6 year old? How to develop a child when he is just from 0 to 6. This has been neglected. You can put it in your new framework. And then how to go about developing the English traits, because English is becoming a global language and the Indians are really poor in this language. Then you can infuse a number of other things like development of the human resource, the quality of the teachers. Then you can also suggest about creating all India teacher services, whereby you can get the quality teachers who can come out and show their prowess in the universities so that we can develop good students. So this was an open-ended question. Show as much as innovation as you feel like in answering such questions. So the third question is, Aadhaar has the potential to offer social security but at the cost of stealing privacy. Now it has, the Aadhaar thing, it has got lot of potential for entering into your privacy. Now, because this Aadhaar is entirely biometrics based, they will be taking your fingerprints, they will be taking your iris scan, and both these things, they can be used by the private companies. You must have heard of something called as data gold mining. Now, data is like gold. And the way you do the gold mining, they can dig a lot out of the data and they can manipulate the people's preferences. They can manipulate the people's choices. You can be targeted the way these companies want. Now this Aadhaar is also more potentially wrong, because apart from just iris and biometrics, your address is there, your caste is there, your name is there, your father's name, your mother's name, everybody's name is there. And it can go on to stalk you. The government can really stalk you. This is a big problem. Nobody has written about stalking by the government. Nobody has written about how the government can manipulate this information and use this information, how the information can be stolen by the private companies, and how the private companies can be behind you about the data mining thing. So this was all that you were supposed to write. You were supposed to write more on the privacy aspect. Now, how can a government stalk you? Again, I will give you an example. Now, suppose they have taken your iris scan. By taking your iris scan, the government knows who you are. Then, suppose somebody has committed a crime, the government knows everybody who they are. Now, somebody has committed a crime and government is looking for that particular person. And government, on the scene of the crime, they have come out with the DNA sample. And out of the DNA sample, they can use the biotechnological techniques to match with your iris and your fingerprints. And using the spy cameras, they can track everybody. So, just for tracking a criminal, catching a criminal, government will end up tracking everybody. And it will be like intruding into the privacy of everyone. So, this is a major problem with this privacy issue. Justify your non-cooperation and civil disobedience will fall apart in nature and scope. Now, when you have to write about the nature and the scope thing, first of all, decode what is meant by nature and what is meant by scope. Now, what is meant by scope? Scope means what was the level of the participation. Scope means who all have participated in non-cooperation and who all have participated in civil disobedience movement. Now, as far as the scope is concerned, there was a less participation in the non-cooperation movement in comparison to civil disobedience movement. Then the scope, you must also talk it about the region wise. Nobody has written it region wise. Which all regions were affected by the non-cooperation movement and which all regions were not affected by the non-cooperation movement in comparison to civil disobedience movement. Then when it comes to the nature aspect, nature, then you have to discuss about what was the demand during non-cooperation movement. And what was the demand during civil disobedience movement? What was the level of the nationalism at the time of the non-cooperation movement? The barometer of the nationalism, it was quite less during non-cooperation movement, but during civil disobedience, it was quite high. Well, why high? Because people were not ready to accept the benevolent despotism of the Britishers. They were looking for their own self-rule. They were looking for the complete autonomy, the Puran Swaraj thing. During non-cooperation movement, it was just about the dominion status. That was more or less the goal, and the goal was confined to just Swaraj. But when it comes to no civil disobedience, at that point of time, the goal post had shifted. The goal post was the Puran Swaraj thing. The goal post was the fundamental and the political rights. The goal post was to throw the Britishers out of the country and to decide everything of our own. But the major issue about the difference between non-cooperation and the civil disobedience was, in the non-cooperation we had the participation of the n number of the people, n number of the communities. The women participated, the Muslims participated, but in the civil disobedience the participation of the Muslims was nowhere near to the participation of them during non-cooperation movement. The reason being the rise of the communal forces in the country at that point of time. And in the non-cooperation movement, the Gandhi's maturity should also be discussed. Gandhi was comparatively less mature and its acceptability of leader was not that high as a leader during 1920s. But his acceptability of leader, and he had grown as a nationalist leader by the time the civil disobedience was there. And how the non-cooperation movement had ended by Johnny Chora incident, and how the civil disobedience movement had ended. Now the last question, emotional intelligence, how it is important for a bureaucrat and how it is lacking in good governance. When you talk about the concept of good governance, it talks about accountability, transparency, freedom, rule of law, etc. But when it comes to emotional intelligence, this concept does not discuss explicitly about emotional intelligence. But in today's world, it is very, very important for a bureaucrat to be emotionally intelligent. Emotionally intelligent means he must be keeping a lot of control on his emotions. So why there is a need to keep a control on the emotions? Because the emotions have a capacity to take over your mind. Your mind becomes a kind of a thing which is completely guided by these emotions. So in order to keep your mind independent of these emotions, we must be aware of that there is something that is existent as emotions. Now this concept of emotional intelligence was given by Daniel Goleman. Now according to this Daniel Goleman, we must be aware of our own emotions, we must be aware of how to control them, we must be able to how to rein in them or to arrest them so that we can face the challenges of the day-to-day life, and this is what is expected from a bureaucrat. And on the other hand, we must also be aware of the emotions of the others, others' feelings, others' desires, others' wishes. Only then we will be able to address their needs properly. This is what is expected from a bureaucrat. And in the new kind of the governance that will be unfolding in the years to come, it will become very, very important. Now why it will become important? Because the civil society's pressures are rising day by day. So this was all for the day. Bye bye, take care, have a nice day.